Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for joining us for this exciting conversation. We're going to start in just a moment as we wait for others to trickle in. I will just quickly introduce myself. I'm Ruth Rosas. I'm a program manager at America Walks, and I'll be joining for the audience Q&A. I'm joined here by Nicole Smith, who is the operations and program manager at America Walks and a bookstagrammer. Nicole is a public health professional and writer who is passionate about making connections with people and organizations. She serves in sharing their stories. Nicole holds a Bachelor of Science degree in biology with a minor in general chemistry and a Master's of Public Health degree with a concentration in nutrition. Nicole is also an alum of the 2019 America Walks National Walking College and has led various community health initiatives focused on walkability and increasing safe physical activity through policy systems and environmental changes. Nicole lives in Marietta, Georgia, and delights in caring for her epic houseplant collection, improving her conversational Spanish, walking, and spending time with her senior dog. She is also an avid reader, enjoys creating book-related content for her bookstagram, so follow her on Booked for Joy and co-hosting book podcasts. Today, Nicole will be interviewing author Veronica Jarvis about her work and her new book, Inclusive Transportation, A Manifesto for Repairing Divided Communities. I'll turn it over to Nicole in just a second. First, I want to thank our partners. We're grateful to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and their Active People Healthy Nation program. They are huge supporters and allies of walkability, and they support these webinars, our walking colleges, and our community change grants. You can stay informed by signing up for their newsletter. We also want to thank EcoConner and Tool Design, who are also allies and supporters of these webinars. Finally, I want to thank our individual donors that support grassroots action. We count on individual donations to provide this and more programming, so thank you for making this work possible. If you have a question, please enter any questions for our panelists and hosts in the Q&A section of your user dashboard down below. After the interview, we'll be answering some of those questions. The webinar is also recorded and it will be uploaded on YouTube, on our YouTube channel. Now I'll turn it over to you, Nicole.
Thanks, Ruth, for the introduction. And I'm just super happy to be here today. I want to start out, though. Obviously, we're here for a book-related webinar about Inclusive Transportation, A Manifesto for Repairing Divided Communities by author Veronica O. Davis. So excited to have her join us today. But we do want to give a plug for the book. We have a discount code for the book. So we are going to give a free copy away at the end of this webinar. So stay tuned until the end. We have selected a winner for a copy of the book. We'll be sending it out. But also, Island Press has offered a 30% off book purchasing code. And it's only good at the link that you can either access through the QR code on the screen, or the link has also been included in the chat. So make sure you pick up a copy of the book. Of course, I have a copy of the book right here. So definitely go out and do that. So I'm going to get us started with just introducing Veronica. So I have your bio here, Veronica. So Veronica O. Davis is Director of Transportation and Drainage Operations for Houston, Texas, leading the team responsible for maintaining and improving the infrastructure that spans Houston's 671 square miles. Veronica has nearly 20 years of experience in engineering and transportation planning. She's an entrepreneur, a civil engineer, co-founding Inspire Green LLC, which manages community, multimodal transportation, and environmental planning and consulting. While at Inspire Green, she led the Vision Zero action plans for Washington, D.C. and the city of Alexandria. And how I met Veronica originally, she also is a former board member of America Walks. So thank you so much for joining us today, Veronica.
Thank you so much for having me.
I'm super excited to just dive into our conversation today. I will say I usually do an outline when I do these book-related webinars. And I had several drafts of my outline because there's just so much to unpack in this book, and we only have a limited amount of time today. So what I want to do is just kind of start out with the foreword. So I remember I read the foreword one evening and I texted a friend. I said, this is going to be good. And the foreword is written by the fantastic Tamika L. Butler. And I just wanted to read a little section at the end of the foreword that I feel like reflects how I felt when I finished the book, and hopefully gives a, you know, a little glimpse into where we're going to go in the conversation today. So Tamika said in the towards the end of the foreword, I feel changed by reading Veronica's book. I hope you feel the same. Turn the page, get started on or continue your justice journey. And when you finish, make a commitment to do more than just talk about equity. The just future Veronica's child and my children deserve is within reach. Like many leaders, Veronica will play a role in getting us there. You can play a role too, or you can get out of the way. And I just felt like, I was just like, yes, when I read that. So I just want to say, you know, first of all, thank you to Tamika for writing that very powerful foreword right out the gate. Mm-hmm. But I just wanted to start out with how I kind of set this up is we're going to journey with the audience through the book. The book mm-hmm. has, you know, 6 main chapters. And I wanted to talk about so much from all of them. But what I did is I pulled a few like bigger points out of each chapter. Mm-hmm. So starting out at the beginning of the book, which I really love how you incorporated some activities, so to speak, for the reader to do, such as at the beginning, writing your transportation story. Mm-hmm. And I never thought about that before. And I've done trainings on, you know, public narrative and storytelling. But I never thought about my personal transportation story. And yours is actually pretty incredible. It's like you were really born to do this work. and you mentioned that in the book. So in the intro, you just start out, show me a transportation network and I will tell you the values of the decision makers who designed it. Mm-hmm. And then you talked about some of your travels and you mentioned Antigua, Guatemala, which as I was reading, I have a giant picture from Antigua because I was there 5 years ago. And I remember that feeling of being there. And so it was just like, it was a whole full circle moment. But I just wanted you to start out with us today and tell us a little bit about your transportation story, because I just think it's fantastic.
Absolutely. So first of all, thank you to America Walks for having me. It's really great to see you, Nicole. We had a brief overlap during my time on the board. And then shout out to Kate, who's in the background. I think background people never get any love, but shout out to Kate in the background. And I know Ruth will join us a little bit later. You know, one, it was part of my transportation stories I talk about, I was born into it. So the funny story of my actual birth, my literal birth, is my mom was obviously pregnant with me, and my dad was working for UMTA, Urban Mass Transit Administration, which is the predecessor to now the Federal Transit Administration, FTA. So my dad was working for UMTA. My mom shows up and they just can't find my dad. And so she's like in labor in the car waiting for my dad to come out. But my family did make it across the Potomac into Virginia. So I was actually born in the Commonwealth of Virginia, but literally almost born into it. And then to have my first job be the building that I was almost born into is a true full circle moment there. But even beyond that, you know, my dad's side, both of my parents were in the transit, the transportation industry. So my mom, human resources, but she worked most of her career, at least most of my life, at New York City Transit Authority. So I spent a lot of time in Brooklyn growing up as a kid when it was like days off from school. And then my dad is a civil engineer like I am. He also has a planning degree like I do. He also started his PhD in engineering, which I did and neither of us finished. But with that, you know, we moved to New Jersey so that he could work for the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey. He spent some time at Sealand, which was then acquired by CSX. And then ended his career at the American Society of Civil Engineers. So very much just my world all the time. My sister's a doctor, and I don't know how she escaped all of this, but I'm in it. And then my dad's dad, so my grandfather, my paternal grandfather, owned Lincoln Cab Company in Raleigh, North Carolina, up until his death. And it's significant because of the fact that the original, the origin of the company was to be able to provide rides really to Black people who couldn't get taxis. And so he grew a company to over 35 taxis. They were also had a contract with some of the schools to move school children. So that was up until his death. And then I do share in the book, which I know if you ever heard me talk, I do share the story of my mom's family growing up in East Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and having her house taken to build the Interstate 10, which connects Florida to California. And I share that story as a reminder to all of us in this work, whether we are an advocate, whether we're an engineer, decision maker, that the people, there are people alive today that remember what these communities were before the highway showed up. And my mother, every now and then she's in her right mind, is still alive today, and she can remember, and she was in high school when this happened. And so all the communities that we work in, they remember. And so sometimes the hostility that comes isn't necessarily about the today. It's, I just remember the pain from 40, you know, 60, 70 years ago, and no one has acknowledged that. Right. And so I do share that part of my story. And then Nicole, as you mentioned, I invite the reader to share their story. One of my favorite lines to say is self-awareness is your most important tool. So how do you go out into communities if you don't have an aware of who you are? And so I invite the reader, and it's not a judgment. It doesn't have to be a dramatic story. It could be very boring of, I walked to school, I walked home, or I drive to school, I drive home. But it was to be able to have people think about how they grew up and the decisions that they make today to move. And it's not some people drive to work, and that is okay. It's not a value judgment, but just, you know, really understand, well, why do you drive to work? And so then you get to, well, I drive to work because the bus only runs every 30 minutes. Aha, you know, or I drive to work because it doesn't get me all the way where I need to go. Or I had a situation I share in the book living in Southeast DC of, you know, there were times when I didn't have a car, it was hard to get to church because there was no bus that would get me to church. I could get downtown faster than I could get to church, which was 2 miles away. So it's really just being able to understand that, because therefore it makes it easier to connect to communities. So when you go into a community and they say, I don't want to use your transit, you can say, I get it. I don't want to use it either. But it's not that I don't like transit. It's not effective for me. So you have a point that then you can connect with communities, you know, whatever your work looks like. And so that's why I have the reader start with really evaluating their own transportation story.
Yeah, and I think that's so important because, you know, I've been walkability, and it was never in my realm of, I definitely did not have your story from the beginning. It was, I was a new public health worker, and we had a grant, as often we do. And, you know, we were supposed to increase physical activity through, you know, any means necessary. And we had a lot of bike activities happening. And my little, you know, secret is that I don't know how to ride a bike. I did start to learn as a kid, and I fell off too many times. I was like, I'm over it. Never learned. And so I didn't know how to really feel confident in that bike space, but I love to walk. So I started working on the walkability pieces when I was still living in Pennsylvania. But I never thought, and then it just evolved from there. And now here I am working for America Walks, right? But like, I never thought about my transportation story. And it was really eye-opening to me because I literally took the time, and I encourage anyone who's watching this webinar to do the same, because it really made me think about, I remember growing up and, you know, I lived in a neighborhood where there were sidewalks. Like, it would have been perfectly fine for me to walk some places, but my parents were like, you're not walking by yourself. When I went to high school, we didn't have buses at our high school. So my dad drove me. And I remember thinking like, whoo, I'm glad I don't have to walk. Like, you know, I get driven to school. Like, it, just walking places was just not a deal because my parents were like, you're not doing it. And, you know, and then I got my license really late because I was always very nervous about driving, and probably still am somewhat today, especially here in the Atlanta area. It makes me a little nervous. So, you know, I just really dug into it, and I'm like, wow. And I do think, thinking about your story, really impacts, like you said, how you're going to work with and relate to other people. So I think that was a really great activity right out the gate to kind of set the stage for this book. The other thing that I really, I would love for you to expand on a little bit is Black Women Bike. And, you know, I loved reading this story of how you were, how you got started with Black Women Bike, but the importance of representation, like that really, you know, that really struck me. And I know when I did join America Walks and you were on the board, and I'm like, I was excited to see you, you know, on the board and learn about all the things that you were doing in transportation space. And it's very true. Like, it does matter to see people who look like you. So tell us a little bit more about Black Women Bike and where it's at today. What's happening
today? So Black Women Bike, it was never an intentional thing. It was like the, you know, kind of the accidental founders, if you will. So this was back in 2011. And we had just had a mayoral election in the DC region. And bikes just became this thing. So you, even though you had two Black candidates for mayor, it's like biking was like this, I don't know, this like emotional thing. And it would became a symbol of gentrification. And so I was relaying a story to the other two co-founders, Najima Frazier, and I mean, Najima Washington and Nse Ufot. And I was talking about how I was biking by housing, you know, some public housing. And this little Black girl was like, "Mommy, it's a Black lady on a bike." And it's representation because she had seen other people biking before, but I was the first person that looked like her. So I felt famous. I'm like, hey. And so we were relaying the story on social media and since then grown to several thousand women at this point in the DC region. And I know there are other bike groups out there, but what makes Black Women Bike unique was one, the focus on biking however you bike. This isn't just going to be a spandex type of a bike situation. Now, if you want to wear spandex, have at it. I have on my bike a sticker that says friends don't let friends wear spandex because I'm not a spandex cyclist and that's okay. But it was being able to create an avenue for you to be able to use your bike however you wanted to use your bike. And so we had different sessions around how to just bike around the streets of DC safely. And so even for people who could ride 100 miles, just didn't feel comfortable or confident riding in the roadway. So we went through, how do you cross the street? How do you make a left turn? And we did all of those things hands-on, how to bike in at night and in the winter so that people could continue to commute. And really what ended up happening was we attracted a lot of young retirees. So at the time I was in my 30s, but most of our membership, we were pulling from women in their 50s and their 60s. Where they were young retirees under the old government system that allowed them to like retire at like 50 or like 55. But also they wanted to be able to stay active. And so we had several women who went through the Bike League's program to be licensed certified cyclist instructors and to be able to teach other women how to bike. And so what ended up happening was we got more and more and more retirees to join and then lead rides. And so where it is today, this again, representation matters. There comes a point in time when I recognized that it wasn't, even though I was still very much involved in the organization, I didn't need to be the face of it because I still represent a very specific type of Black woman, right? So I am lean. So there's an assumption I'm fit, but we can debate whether how fit I am. But I am lean. I have a younger appearance. And so that's when we pivoted and started putting some of the other members forward, women who were thicker, right? Because there's a, oh, well, you can bite because you look how tiny you are. You can bite. Okay, cool. I'm gonna put, you know, I got some big booty Judies, you know, we can put them up there and have them be the face of the organization and getting different sizes, different ages, and having that representation. And so it's been a beautiful thing to be able to still see it move forward and blossom and see the women still partaking and still having rides and all of the activities that they're doing. And then the advocacy piece was also making sure we had members that were on the Bicycle Advisory Council so that as decisions and recommendations are being made to the council, that we can have a seat at the table, if not two or three seats at the table.
Right. Love that. So let's dive into chapter two, which is titled Equity is More Than a Baseball Graphic. And I think we've all seen the picture. I knew right away. I was like, I knew the picture. I saw it with the three kids and the different, you know, the crates, mm-hmm. and they're looking over at the baseball game. And that is our definition of equity. That is our photo that comes to mind. And you break that down a bit in this chapter and give some other perspectives as well of visuals about what is equity. And I like how, I feel like in this chapter, first of all, again, you give us a little assignment to define equity for ourselves. What do we feel mm-hmm. equity is for ourselves? And you don't fully give us the, you let us sit with it in chapter two. And I actually think that is really, was really helpful and effective, because I hate to say, you know, equity is a buzzword and people use it. And it's like, do you actually know like what that means? And then there's equity and then there's equality. And, you know, you dive into that as well in this chapter. But what I really like is the analogy that you have for equity in relating it to how things would work in an emergency room. And I think that is just a really helpful situation. You know, I'm sure most of us have had this experience of like a triage experience. Share with us kind of, first of all, what your feelings are about equity right now. And I know you also had mentioned, I don't know if it was in chapter two, but somewhere in the book, you know, it's also become like a tension point, which equity mm-hmm. should never be a tension point, right? But it is, and it's been attached to a lot of things of, you know, what's being taken away. Am I going to be missing out on something? You know, it's been tied to, you know, having like a political connotation, and all these things have been attached to equity. But I would love for you to expand on that for us, and also give us just a little scenario about like this emergency room analogy, which I think is very fitting.
Yeah, so I'm just gonna give a little bit because I gotta read the book to get the full bit. Yeah. So it is a spoiler. I don't really define equity because it really is going to be different depending on what your problem is, what your community is, and what's going on. So it is going to be different. And I didn't want to provide a definition because especially with my engineers, you give them a definition, they are like, that this is the definition. It's like, no. It can be more than that. So that's part of the reason why I didn't provide a specific definition. But I give an example of an emergency room, because the challenge with the equity of, you know, qualities is everyone gets the same equity, everyone gets what they need. We all know there is no community, no city that it has the ability to give everybody what they need. We know that our infrastructure needs, even in small cities, is going to be in the hundreds and hundreds of millions. You have bigger cities, you're probably closer into the billions. So I cannot give everybody what they need. And so it becomes about prioritization. And so when you go to an emergency room, the two of us, heavens forbid, go to the emergency room, we get there at the same time, you know, we're asked, hey, what's going on? Why are you here? There's an intake process. So I might be in just because I have a headache. And I might be a little bit of a hypochondriac, and I might, and my headache may need to be solved, but it's not that critical. You know, you might be in for a different reason. And so, you know, the ER has their process for how they see patients, and it's not about your race, not about your income. They're assessing, okay, what resources do we have available? Doctor, nurses, beds, the little fake rooms with the curtain. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a finite amount available. And then, so they have to assess, what are the resources available? What are your symptoms? How serious are your symptoms? And so then you're seen in that order. But if someone comes in that they are, I don't know what to call it, code blue. I watched just enough Grey's Anatomy to be dangerous. But you know, if someone comes in and they are, it's dire. It didn't really matter that they can't, you've been waiting for 4 hours. They will go before you because they are more critical than you are. And so it comes down to prioritization, and that's what equity is. And no one really wants to say that part out loud because we're trying to do everything for everybody. We're trying to, okay, let me give you a little bit. Let me give you a little bit. And, you know, I hear it too, where you have communities that are like, my community is unsafe. Is it unsafe? I mean, maybe, but the reality is it's probably not that bad. everything could be safer, right? But then it's like, you're now at the incremental of like the amount of money that you're putting in to make it incrementally safer. Like, is that a good use of resources? Or do you put the resources where we know people are dying and are seriously injured? And I think that is the challenge of being able to have a framework to say, no, we are going to focus on our high injury network. And yes, I hear you, and I'm gonna get to you, but I gotta deal with this first. So if you let me deal with this and use my resources, my staff, my money, my resources to handle this other thing, I can circle back and get to you. And it's hard because it takes a lot of political will to do. And so spoiler in chapter 6, I talk about that, you know, to really be able to get to the point of equity, you know, that's where you have to have political will. You have to have bold leadership to be able to say, no, we said this is important and I hear you. But we're going to move forward and do this thing. And that becomes hard. Therefore, spoiler, one of the actions, call to actions, is hire, you know, you guys elect better leaders so that we can get better projects and have better decision making.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I do, I agree with what you're saying about like not giving it all away on equity, because I do think it's something, I mean, obviously the words used a lot as a public health person, like all about, you know, talk about equity a lot, but I as I was going through this chapter, it really, like, you really give the reader some things to really sit with. That's what I like about this book. Like, you have to sit with a lot of things in this book.
To say, for those of you that haven't read the book is literally structured for you to sit with something and work through it. I don't give you all the answers because I didn't want this to be a book that you read it and you're like, I did the equity, great job, and you put it back on your shelf. Mm-hmm. I did want it to be a book that you go back to say, you know what, hold on, I gotta go back and work this again because I'm in a different situation. And so there's a lot of sitting and marinating and reflecting as you go through the book.
Yes, and I like that there are even prompts, like reflection prompts and all of that. But the big thing that I, one of the big takeaways is when you talk about restoration as well. Like, there's a lot where, because you were sharing about, was it your archaeology class? That was really pivotal. Is that what it was? Like, you know, just thinking about like looking back. And it's funny because we have a staff member who has a similar background and story. And I never think about, like, you know, you could go way, way back and you can still relate it to what's going on now. And I know also in the book, you talk about like history doesn't have to be like when you're assessing the history of a community, it doesn't have to be like what happened like 50 years ago. It could be what happened last year. But really having this focus, when you're talking about equity, having this restoration focus. And I think that really, you know, sat with me, like when I was reading, that you said that, you know, it's more than just checking the engagement box, because that's a whole other thing, you know, trying to restore, a community and restore a neighborhood. That's more than just saying, you know, oh, well, we're going to go in and, you know, try to meet your needs or have the conversations. There needs to be like a really, a much higher level of intention, with that. And, but the next thing is, in chapter 3, we talk about, it's titled, Should There Be a War on Cars? And I'm sure, you know, it's not that you, and you stated like, you're not anti, you know, anti-car. And I think a lot of us aren't, you know, but it is without a doubt that the infrastructure, everything's being designed around cars, you know, for cars. So that's really the discussion point, is we have to move away from that. And I love how you're talking about, you know, which we all know, okay, solo travel, you got one person in the car, all these cars have one person going a lot of different places. And, you know, it's much more efficient to move a lot more people in a lesser of a transit mode, you know, buses, you know, if you want a bike, whatever. But I always say, like, it's good to have those options. I, as a driver, you know, driving place, I don't want to drive like just by myself. I don't want to have to, you know, hop in the car just to take short trips all the time. And, you know, I'm fortunate enough that, you know, like just literally this year, I live in a community where I can walk to do a lot of the things that, especially entertainment, you know, that kind of stuff. But not everybody has that option. Not everybody has that access to do those things. And so I put here in my notes too, thinking about building the roads for the busiest time of the day. So when you're moving, when the most amount of people are out and about, but what about the rest of that? People are using these, like, you know, the roads get wider and wider and wider, and the speeds get faster and faster. And, you know, taking all that into consideration. Also, we're talking about, as you mentioned earlier, about the highways, you know, being put in, you know, the racist practices behind where highways were placed. This chapter really had me. I was just like, I was highlighting all the things in this chapter because it's just so deep. You know what I mean? It's such a deep conversation.
Well, it makes the connection of, especially for you, you know, coming from the public health side, it makes the connection of how infrastructure is impacting public health. Yes. You know, when you think about asthma rates, when you think about all of these things, even, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the high injury network, if you show me, all you can do is show me a map of any city and point out to me where the 6 lane or more roads are, and I could probably show you where your high injury network is. And that's just consistent across every community. And so we've created roads that are so wide. And I can even say here, you know, in Houston, we have roads that are 5 lanes in the middle of downtown. Like, what are we doing? And then what happens is during those off-peak hours, you've made essentially highways through communities, even in residential neighborhoods where you have a 6-lane road, you've created highways during those off-peak times. And we're not getting it. And I will say, at least the Institute of Traffic Engineers, ITE, they are the ones, they're grappling with, okay, hold up, how do we change the design standards? How do we change how we do this? How do we change traffic engineering so that things can be safer? And it takes time, and I think we'll eventually get there. But giving more people, I think what happens, and part of the reason why I had to rewrite chapter 6, live in here, it's even though there are some people, we cling to the car so much that we feel like everyone should be able to drive. And it's like, time out, just because you want to drive your car doesn't mean everybody wants to make that same decision. And so it's a challenge at every, I mean, I can't think of a city, it's not a challenge of when you try to take away a lane of traffic for someone else, whether it's for transit or for biking, try to take away one parking space and see what happens. You know, it's a very emotional thing. And so, you know, it does take rethinking how we plan our cities. And sometimes saying, hey, we might be okay with a little bit of traffic during the rush hour, or we may need to facilitate it in different ways and provide more options for people so that they're not, so we just don't have traffic for traffic's sake.
Right. And we actually have an upcoming workshop that we'll be doing in Arkansas. And we had a planning meeting about 2 hours after I finished this book. And I was like, so I have some things that I would like to incorporate because, you know, there is a citizen who's concerned about parking, for example. And not that she's not concerned with the rest of the goings on in the neighborhood as far as safety and all of that. But I like how kind of flowing into chapter 4, talking about power and influence and working with people. It's kind of like what are the benefits to the different groups of people? And you know, really listening to that. And in chapter 4, you talk about, you kind of like sum up 3 categories. I'm sure, you know, it's not to put people in like huge buckets, but the naysayers, the champions, and the silently suffering. And I think we all know the naysayers, right? Like they stand out and oftentimes can be the loudest, mm-hmm. But not to be ignored, you know, like you say in this chapter. But you have to know the right questions to ask the naysayers. And the champions, we all want the champions because, you know, as you state, oftentimes they're the ones, like if you're doing a community meeting, for example, they may have been on the front lines of getting that started to begin with. So we all would love to work with the champions. But the section about the silently suffering, as you say, that is where the test of equity will happen. And mm-hmm. I think that, it puts a word to, you know, I was thinking back in my own public engagement activities that the more I've learned, the more I've realized what I've not done well, you know, and I just think that it's really key that you had mentioned that it can be tempting to speak for them, which can sometimes lead to speaking over them. The name silently suffering does not imply that you need to save them. And I think just leaving, you know, having space for people who are often, it might take a little bit more work, right, to get them to speak up, to get them to the meetings, to, you know, figure out how to, you know, make the timing work so that they can be present in the conversation and not maybe just do, you know, quick outreach and check that box like, oh, we tried to reach them, but, you know.
Right. And also, I mean, what I talk about with the silently suffering is you actually may need to go to them mm-hmm. or go to people that work with them. And it will depend on every community. And so just I give an example in the book of a transit project where there were people who are dependent on the bus, but they work shifts. They're not working a traditional, you know, 9-to-5 office schedule. And so setting up a meeting literally in the bus stop. So there was no, you don't have to go to some stale elementary school basement with the little cockroach on the side. You know, you get a chance to step off the bus. Oh, I'm in a meeting. Okay, cool. Yeah. And then you have to be focused because you only get about 2 minutes. That's it. And so in that 2 minutes, being very focused in the questions that you're asking them. And we got really great feedback and having the data to show that the feedback we got from that mechanism more closely, the demographics more closely match the community than if we were to have it in a stale elementary school basement with the old pizza. Mm-hmm. So I talk about that. One thing I don't share in the book, but you know, just another example, sometimes it may be hard to engage a very specific population for a variety of different reasons. And so when we worked on a long-range plan for one of the cities I was consulting with, we actually had a meeting with providers of people who provide services for the unhoused population. And so having an understanding of people who work with a very specific population day in and day out. We also had people who worked with undocumented people and that whole population, because if you show up as the government to talk to certain people, it's just, it's just not gonna go well. But right. that the people who work with them every single day, not to speak over them or for them, but can give you insights on challenges around being able to move or challenges around mobility. And so that's where with the silently suffering, it's a care you have to take, especially if you work for city government or state. If you work for government, it doesn't matter. You are government and you have to understand that you might not be perceived well and you may have to go another avenue in order to communicate with that group. But it has to be intentional and they're not going to come to you. You know, yes, I know people do babysitting and those are all good things, but there's still a recognition of the population. You know, when people say, oh, nobody bikes here. Yes, they do. You just don't see them, but they are there and they're biking in very treacherous conditions, risking their life because they don't have any other choices. And right. so it is, again, you know, being cognizant of that and being open and looking for that and then being very intentional of how you reach that group.
Mm-hmm. And it is awkward as to someone who did work for city government. And I'm like, but I don't understand. Like, but I'm here to listen. But I still had that badge on, like the badge mm-hmm. of city government. So already it's like, we don't need what you're selling, you know? But yeah, I just think that that's one of the things I really liked about chapter 4. And, you know, there's so much out there about how to do public engagement well, how to do it better, how to do it at all. You do acknowledge also in kind of rolling into chapter 5 about, which is titled Bringing People and Planning Together. It's not that people don't care. It's not that, you know, planners or government workers or whoever is doing the data collection and the research, it's not that they don't care, but a lot of people are not trained per se on how to do that piece of the work.
No one is trained on it. Yeah. I'm going to take it a step further. I have been an engineer my entire career. And I don't know, maybe the curriculum is different, but I know that as a civil engineer, I got zero training on public outreach, how to communicate to the public, zero. Even as a planner, you may work with communities, but you don't learn how to design a meeting and design outreach so that such that it could actually inform what you're trying to do. Mm-hmm. And again, it's been some years, maybe a decade or two since I've been in school, and maybe things have changed, but I think that's just kind of the root challenge. And part of, honestly, my motivation for writing the book is to have a resource available for people going through school so that they can understand. And anytime I know I encounter, particularly young engineers tend to, you know, reach out to me, it's the most important class you can take is a communications class. You have to get your speech from technical to the living room. And it's very, very hard because we live in our world, we live in our bubble, we talk with our colleagues all day and our acronyms and our all these other things. The average person has no idea what you're talking about. And right. So explain it in a way that's clear and concise. That a 10-year-old should be able to listen to you talk and understand exactly what you're saying. And that is very hard. But I just want to be very clear. No one's trained on it.
Yes. And I do I do want to encourage people, like, that's another reason, like, get the book, because you do offer some you offer a lot of examples, but you offer, you know, some action steps and things to incorporate. Would you say that growing up the way you did and how what you shared in your transportation story helped you to, because I mean, you were open in the book, like you've had incidences where you were doing public engagement and it wasn't ideal either.
Oh, absolutely.
Would you say it's still a learning process? Because I'm sure, you know, obviously every community, every person is not the same. Your approaches need to adjust. But would you say, is it something that's maybe inherent in you of how to engage with people, or since you didn't learn, or is it something you just kind of had to learn as you went? As well,
I will say it's something that you have to learn as you go, but I also think you have to try to learn as you go, because there's a lot of people that have a very bad public engagement experience and they're like, oh no, that was terrible, don't ever want to do it again, they clam up. So I do share in the introduction, actually, in chapter one, some people who have mentored me. So one is I sought out people who I thought did a good job at doing it. And so I talk about Jair Lynch. And so I worked as a summer intern for him, and he's a developer in the DC area. And watching him and present, and it's like, okay, let me listen, let me learn. And so taking that time to observe people's styles, how they interact. I've definitely gotten my hand slapped before. And honestly, once my meeting, and I share in the book about a public meeting I had that was so terrible, it was terrible. That I learned that the library had their own police department, and only because they shut down the meeting. And I was so thankful. I went home. I like poured a glass of bourbon. I had to go beyond wine. I like poured a glass of bourbon, and I was like, oh my God, I have failed. I have failed miserably. But from that experience, I will say I'm not scared of crowds anymore. I'm just like, oh, I mean, what's the worst that could happen? The police show up. So it's all a learning experience, but I also think it's part, and I talk about this in chapter six, and what I try to do, I'm not going to say that I'm perfect, is I do give a call to action. And part of it is empathy, is really exercising that empathy muscle. And it's not something that you can just do once and just keep moving. It really is about attempting to immerse yourself in a world where you are decentered. Now, as a Black woman, I'm usually never centered. But there's other privileges that I have. You know, the fact that I can get up and run down the sidewalk right now. There's a lot of people that are unable to do that for a variety of different reasons. And so it's living and immersing yourself in different communities where you are decentered. And so I do my best to be intentional, and I'm not perfect with it. One of the people I cite, I acknowledge in my book is Dara Baldwin. If you've ever met Dara Baldwin, you've probably gotten fussed out by Dara Baldwin. And I love, 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 love her. Part of my like heart trust. And what I love about her is she works in the disability rights space. And I know she has corrected me multiple times around language, around things. And so it's easy to get defensive and say, "What? That's not what I meant." No, okay, hold up. All right, thank you. Thank you for giving me that opportunity to learn. And now let me go do some more work. And so I do my best to, even like I share on social media, I love to follow the disability community and listen to the conversation, because it's things that come up that it's like, oh, I didn't even think about that. Okay. Well, yes, I can see how I had the assumption. Let me check myself. That comes from being intentional. And so all of those things, the more you can open yourself up to different people in the world and different experiences that may be different from your own, I think the better off overall that you can be as you continue to work with different communities. But again, it has to be intentional. It doesn't need to be performative. We don't need performance. It needs to be intentional. And then that's also to look at your friend group. If all your friends are the same type of friends, you know, how are you opening yourself up to new people, new experiences, and new relationships that you can get to know some different people on a different, more intimate level?
Mm-hmm. Those are excellent, excellent tips and action items. And I know we're at the portion where we should be starting our Q&A now from the audience. So we had a great discussion. Now we're going to bring the audience in with some questions, and Ruth's going to help with that. Welcome back, Ruth.
Hello. Yeah, we have a couple of questions in the Q&A. I did want to, or somebody did ask if it's available in audio or large print.
So audio right now, it is not available. I know that Island Press, I've gotten the feedback, and you know, if you're gonna have an inclusive book, you should probably be inclusive. Island Press, we've been having conversations about how to make an audio book. Large print is not available. However, if you download the digital version, there is the ability then to make it bigger and easier to read.
Awesome. Thank you.
I wanted to, I'll add to that. I don't know if this is fitting to add, but I am an audiobook person. Like probably I listen to probably 80 to 90 audiobooks a year. And I do very well when I listen and read at the same time when I'm like reading to understand. So I have the, you know, the paperback, which everybody should get, but I also have the Kindle version. And I have two different Kindles, and the one has Alexa on it. So she actually read it to me. And then I was able to read along and do my highlighting because I do well listening. So that's, you know, that's also an option if you can get the Kindle version and get the paperback version too. And then you can listen and read at the same time. It's not your voice though. So definitely if there's an audiobook, I'm putting in.
I don't know. My voice is so sultry. It's like, you can sleep.
Awesome. Well, another question an audience member asks is, I'm in San Francisco, but I'm sure this is true in other cities. Advocating with transportational professionals, especially engineers, often results in lots of pushback from either car-oriented thinking or concerns about politics. How can advocates be more successful in this regard, especially for marginalized communities and silently suffering who are already dismissed or ignored?
I'll say a few things. I think one, it's one about building coalitions. There's a lot of people who work around transportation, but never really get in it. And so that's an opportunity for advocates that are in the transportation world to bring in others there. And that's kind of easier said than done. I do share in the book of you just gotta like better politics. I mean, politics are gonna be politics and all politics are local. And so it kind of similar to coalition building, but it is taking the time to have elect better people, but also create a pipeline so that you can elect better people. As you think about most cities, there is gonna be advisory boards out the wazoo. So there's gonna be a bicycle advisory board, probably a pedestrian advisory board, probably a disabilities or some type of disability rights or advocacy advisory board. Those are all opportunities to show up and lend your voice and to meet new people and to be able to build coalitions with different people in your group. And then you have, you know, your council member, all your elected people, but you got to play the long game. And I know it's hard because advocates want me to give them like the thing they can do today. And in 90 days, I could do this thing. And I've checked off that I've been successful. But you really got to have a long-term vision. for how you are going to get to better decision-making. And I know it's hard. There's an urgency that happens, and you got to pay attention to what's happening right here and now, but really taking the time through coalitions to come up with your long-term plan and your long-term advocacy plan and strategy. And I know advocates don't like to hear that.
Awesome. Really important. Another question, what resources can you recommend for a tiny nonprofit to plan outreach in underserved communities?
Resources, like financial resources, or, because I will say American Walks does have grants available for certain communities. And you know, there's always grants that are available. I will say the smaller grant organizations are going to be better. The bigger the foundation or grant organization, the more paperwork you're going to have to do. Just putting that out there. So I'll say that's one thing. I think the other thing is starting small. Engagement, I know that I used to have the numbers memorized, but on the street engagement is significantly cheaper and less work to then have a meeting that you have people come to. So just consider that. Even as a small nonprofit, you can put the same t-shirt on and go outside and stand on the corner. And that is a very low cost engagement activity. Even when I was a consultant, I was able to show my clients, we could do one big meeting and it's going to cost, you know, XXX. Or we could take this one big meeting and make four smaller meetings, have a bigger impact, and still maybe save a little bit of money because you don't have to advertise the meeting as much as possible. People will show up and they will walk into the meeting. So all those are things to consider.
Awesome. Great. And for the community change grants, we do offer community change grants. The application's closed, but we do open it up. So feel free to look that up. Another question. In Albuquerque, it's similar to kind of what you were talking about, but in Albuquerque, we're organizing for transit equity and mobility sovereignty for more than 6 years, including zero fares or free public transit. How do we convince engineers and planners to authentically engage with most impacted communities?
So part of getting them to do, so I talk a little bit about in chapter 4, the people in power. You got to get to the people in power. And so even if you can't get to the people in power, they're influenced by somebody. And so that part of the book is really work of sitting down and writing out who are the decision makers, who has power to have someone make a different decision or consider a different decision. And it's doing that power analysis and figuring out how to get to that person and being strategic in how you get to that person. Now, what that doesn't mean is you email the decision maker and say, you will do these things. Like, no. Say, hey, I'll pick on myself. So, hey, Director Davis, I see that there's this project coming up and my group wants to come and talk to you about the things that are important, that are impacting different communities. Can we have 30 minutes of your time? Here's some reading materials in advance. And I will say, this isn't necessarily about the book, but you know, from my experience in Houston, I've had that where advocacy groups that are very vocal, but have come to me with specific questions and not just accusations, but hey, we're coming to the table with solutions. Here's what we think. How do we get there? What is preventing us to get to this vision? And so we sat down with my team to say, okay, well, here's some of the things. It's a funding, it's a this, it's a operations, and sit down. And so over a little bit over a year's time, we through their advocacy and through their influence working with elected leaders, my team was able to get the funding needed. I didn't request it. This did not come from me, but my team was able to get the funding needed and the ordinance needed in order to achieve what they were attempting to achieve. So that's the thing about being strategic. It's don't just show up with the decision maker saying, hey, what are you going to do? Hey, here's our ideas. This is why we think it should be free. Here's an interim step that we can make. Can we do a pilot project? Pilots are really great. Can we do a pilot project from this time to this time, just to see how it operates and look at ridership? Those are all the type of things that you can bring to the people in power. And you just gotta be persistent, but respectful.
for your advice. We have two more questions. Do you have any thoughts or recommendations for transit and other transportation metrics that may be more holistic and effective with gauging benefits and equity for all than those historically used and federally mandated metrics, with which is often in practice secondary, Title VI evaluations?
Yeah, so I'll give two examples. So one example of a metric, so typically traffic engineers, God bless them, they use what's called level of service. And for those of you that don't know, it's a simple formula. You get a grade level. So it's kind of like in school, A is good, supposed to be real fast. F is you have failed. So A, B, C, D, E, F, and that's the grade level. And what that is, it's volume over capacity. So the volume is just the number of vehicles that have to move through an area. The capacity is the number of vehicles you could fit in that area. And so you have an F when the volume of traffic is exceeding the amount of space available for those particular vehicles. And so that is the metric. And that's why we keep widening the roads, because if you want to get to a better level of service, if you want to go from an F to an E or an E to a D, D to a C, you got to get capacity from somewhere. You either got to reduce the volume or increase the capacity. And what people tend to do is just, oh, we'll increase the capacity. And so when you understand that, a very simple metric, and some cities are exploring this, was called multimodal level of service. So as long as I'm only focused on vehicles, I'm going to get to the same outcome. But if I focus on the number of people that I can move in multiple types of modes, well, then now it's a little bit different, because I have added more opportunities to move more volume in the same capacity. So I could have 50 people sitting in cars by themselves, or 50 people on a bus. So 50 people on a bus takes up less space. So that's one particular metric. The other metric on the equity side, I know Title VI is very like check a box. Okay, did you do all these things? One of the things I like to do, it's not just collecting the Title VI data in the form and have people fill it out, but compare it to the neighborhood. Who showed up at your meeting, and how does that compare to the demographics of that neighborhood? And if it's off, you got more work to do. And I'll give a very solid example. I don't talk about this in the book, but this is an example. I worked on a project where we had a public meeting in a government building that required ID to get into. And it was a 4-hour meeting. And so we did a long meeting with two separate presentations. And we had about 100 or 200 something people show up during that time span, mostly white. The earlier presentation was mostly older seniors who wanted to come early and get home before it got dark. The later one was younger people. And so that was a demographic that did not reflect the community. We had another meeting on the same exact block outside, same block. Outside, the demographics of the people that attended the meeting outside reflected the community. And it wasn't a perfect reflection, because I know children always, kinds of throws things off. But for the adults, it almost perfectly matched the community in terms of ethnicity, in terms of income. So all that to say, it's as you're collecting the Title VI data, it's not just about, I tried to reach out to them. It's, are you actually reflecting the overall community? And if not, you have more work to do.
Yeah, that makes sense. And kind of in that similar engagement question, if you're an organization or an individual that doesn't have community engagement experience, is it better to hire a community engagement firm that does have the experience and training, or should you attempt to be involved yourself since you are closer to the issue and ultimately shaping the plan and recommendations? They could see trade-offs with the community engagement firm not having the topic area expertise, and yet they may be able to communicate the ideas in a simpler form.
I'm not going to answer either of those. I think the better option is to hire an engagement firm that can train you to do the engagement. The more you can do it yourself, and that's not to say they can't supplement your staff. You got to do the work. If you're going to be in it for communities, you have to be the one that shows up. And it's hard to do. It means stepping outside of your comfort zone. But the training is important so that you can understand, how do I communicate to different people? What are some things that I can do? Maybe the engagement firm can help you develop your outreach strategy but you got to do the work. Even if they can supplement you, but you have to be the face. You are the organization. You are the one with the passion. You have to be the face of the, you know, to the community. And it takes time to build those relationships with the community.
I think that's a really great point. And thank you so much, audience, for the great questions. Those were really good questions.
Those are hard questions.
So we're at the end of our time. I do want to announce our book winner. So our book winner is, little drum roll, Tatiana Quinones. You have won a copy of the book, Inclusive Transportation, and I will be sending that out to you. We have your info, and we'll get in touch to get your address and all that good stuff. So thank you so much for everybody who attended today. Thank you so much, Veronica, for being here. It was a great conversation. It was great to see you again. And I just can't encourage everyone enough to get this book. I know we probably had some unanswered questions. I will say, get the book and you'll probably have a lot of your questions answered. So I am going to pass it on to Ruth to close us out for the day.
Thank you so much. As always, thank you for joining us for this great interview with Veronica Davis. And we couldn't do this work without you and your donations. Every bit counts. There is a link in the chat if you'd like to donate. And we hope to see you at the next webinar, which we will be co-hosting with NOISE, or National Organization for Youth Safety, the Voices of the Next Generation in Transportation, on November 16th. The link is also in the chat. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone.